continuum three and four dimensional Yankin series. We're heading up really to the study of the four dimensional theory of crucial importance to the real world, because the weak and the strong interactions in the real world are governed by Yankin's theories. One of the things I want to do is to compute this, the beta function, the one loop beta function of U. While this calculation is in principle about as simple as that for the 5 to the 4th theory, remember we got this factor 3 by 16, 16 pi squared, etc. There's nothing really more to it than that little one calculation. But it's mired in extra technicalities because of these issues of gauge invariance. Okay. So in preparation for the study we're going to perform, I'm going to have a little technical lecture on this thing called the quantum effect of action. This lecture is really taken almost entirely out of chapter 16 of Weinberg's... Chapter 16 of Weinberg's... Weinberg's book of quantum field theory, which is a very nice little chapter.
So why the exact
renormalization
equation is not valid for
gauge theory? The exact renormalization equation is not valid for gauge theories because the way that we set up the calculation, we had a cutoff in both sides. Now, that's a very dangerous thing to do for gauge theory for all of the following reasons. You see, the gauge transformation is delta I mu is equal to del mu epsilon plus A mu. Okay. Now, suppose we put a cutoff in momentum space. Okay. Suppose you try to put a cutoff in momentum space in saying that all our gauge fields have momenta less than a certain amount. That's not a gauge invariant state. Because if in one gauge, the gauge field has momenta restricted to a certain shell, in another gauge, depending on what your epsilon is, okay, it can have momenta outside that shell. Okay? So
all those RT flow and everything, you can have
things basically. RT flow is correct, it's just a technical issue. Nobody's managed to formulate as beautiful a set of exact renormalization group equations for scalars. Of course, you think they exist. This is for the lattice. By some block spinning or something like that. It exists. But it would be very nice to have something as lovely as the Polchinski equations for gauge theories. I don't think that's been achieved. But you should think of it as conceptually existing. Okay. So the problem is really putting a cutoff. Okay? The problem is in regulating gauge theories in a manner that preserves gauge invariance. Okay? So we have this beautiful finite regulator for the scalar field, just by taking the propagator and modifying it. And that's another way of saying it. If you just try to modify the propagator of a gauge of gauge theory without, you can't. Propagator is part of F mu nu squared. You can't fool around with the propagator by itself. That will violate gauge invariance. Okay? So, the good gauge invariant regulator, the really useful gauge invariant regulator we have, is this thing called dimensional regularization. Okay? Which is very nice, but doesn't have this a finite version. We'll discuss this as we study gauge invariance. Okay, but that's the main issue. Main issue is that it's harder to regulate gauge theories in a manner that preserves gauge invariance. That was one of the most main motivations for introducing lattice. It is an explicit gauge invariant regulator of the gauge theory as we discussed. Okay, fine.
So,
yeah.
So when you derive this exact equation, you ensure the partition function is independent of the scale. So when we are not doing by this method and when we are calculating just the one loop diagram, so how are we sure that partition function will still be scale independent? Because we don't demand any condition over there to make partition function.
Well, you know, you have to understand what you. It's a question of what you mean by the renormalization. But if you are referring to the kind of thing people normally do in textbooks for renormalization, what we do is to tune the bear action. So we put some sort of scale in the bear action. You know, either that's a cutoff or it's an eventual regulated scale. Okay? And you have some bear parameters. And then you try to tune the bear parameters as a function of the scale so that something finite, okay, is unaffected. So it is the same thing. Because you see, what was not important was not that the partition function was unaffected, but that the generator of correlation functions was unaffected. The correlation functions are the finite things you measure. So what you normally do is the same thing, except that what is normally done is only at infinity. The great thing about the Polchinski renormalization root equation society, Wilson's, but made so explicit to Polchinski, is that it allowed you to go all the way down to finite scales. The thing high energy textbooks normally do is just at infinity. So the thing that they do is what we proved using the Polchinski equations. If you remember, we had these finite equations, and then we demonstrated that it was possible to choose bare parameters as a function of lambda part, so as to keep renormalized parameters at some low scale. It's that second part that is normally called. Okay? So it's slightly different but related. The precise relation is what we tried to explain. Okay. Okay, good. Anything else? Okay. So as I discussed today, we will, in preparation for our discussion of the computation of the beta function and some physics of Yang's theories, we're going to have a technical aside in this lecture to discuss what's called the quantum effect of action. So what is the quantum effect of action? It's a general notion of quantum field theory, applies to gauge theory, scalar theory, and so on. I'm going to, the notation I will use in describing it is that of a scalar theory. It's very general. Okay. So consider we had, for instance, some theory. We've got a partition function, which is described as follows. Now, as you all know, this is the object that we used also in discussing Polchinski renormalization. It's often convenient to have a source to this action. It's often convenient to have a source to this partition function. If you can compute this path integral in the presence of the source, you can then compute all kinds of correlation functions of the field that is coupled to the source, just by differentiation. Okay? In particular, this is clear, right? So you can compute. You take the log of Z, differentiate it with respect to many J's, and you get the correlations of those paths. So this is, of course, a useful object. In particular, now a word about this object. Firstly, it is useful to write this Z of J, whatever it is, as e to the power w. Why is this useful? This is useful on diagrammatic. It's useful for many reasons. But the first motivation is diagrammatic. The point is this. See, this is a partition function in the presence of some source. Okay? Now, a partition function gets contributions from all kinds of diagrams. Okay? However, the contributions from diagrams that are disconnected to each other, okay, can be dealt with in a rather trivial way, in the sense that there's a theorem that says that the set of all diagrams is simply the exponential of the sum of all connected diagrams. Okay? Now, all of you know this, but I'll just illustrate this as an example, just so that you see how it works. Okay, suppose we had Python-4 theory. Okay? And we had a diagram like this. And another diagram like this, for instance. Okay, so what I'm going to do is to first compute. It's just an issue of getting the symmetric like this, right? Okay, so what I'm going to do is to first compute. Okay, and what I'm going to do is first compute. Maybe I should take more. Let me start with the following. Let me start with. Okay, let me start with three again, the graphs, and then I take two or three of the examples. Okay, so suppose we wanted to look at this diagram. Okay, so suppose our action had a lambda 4, 5, okay, so what is this graph? Okay, so firstly, what is the expected? What is the value of this graph? So what do we have to do to get this graph? Just one of one things. We bring down a factor of minus lambda 4 by 2. Okay, that comes with a factor of 1. And then we have to contract 2 phi's to 2 alpha phi's. Okay? So there are 4 phi's in the game. We choose 2 phi's to contract with each other. So these are the 4 phi's. We choose any 2 of these phi's to contract with each other. These can be chosen 4 into 3 ways. Then we contract the remaining 2 phi's. There's no choice. Okay? So if I have this as lambda phi to the 4 by 4 factorial, suppose I put that to be the numbers that look a little nicer. This graph would appear with factor 4 into 3 by 4 factorial. So it would appear with factor minus lambda 4 by 2. And then with the final integrals of this graph, which of course you know very well, right? 1 over m squared plus b squared integrated, whole thing squared. Okay, so this would be the factor for this graph. Now, suppose I wanted this graph. Okay, suppose I wanted this graph. So then I would have bring down 3 factors of this graph. What does that come with? Because we're expanding an exponential, it comes with 1 over 3 factorial. Okay, so it comes with minus lambda 4 u by 3 factorial. And then each lambda 4 comes with this 1 over 4 factorial. Okay. And now, in order to get this graph, for each of these, I have to do the same thing as I did before. So for each of these, I will get the factor of 4 into 3. Okay. So this will make this half cube, which is clearly minus lambda 4 by 2 cube by 3 factorial. Okay.
Whole thing permutations.
You see, there is this way of thinking of these things using symmetric factors using these permutations. I'm not doing that, I'm just counting.
Okay.
So I've just brought down the factors.
Okay.
I'm counting the number of ways of connecting.
Okay.
I've always found that way of these rules for symmetric factors extremely confusing. So I know some people seem to magically produce the right answer. I've never quite understood that. I always come. Okay? You see, this is almost trivial. We're just doing the same thing for each set of vertices that we would for one graph. But because of the 1 over 3 factorial, that from expanding the exponential, we got this 1 over 3 factorial. And that tells you that the whole thing was expanded. Okay. Now, if you had different graphs, actually it's the same thing for the sum of all the integrals. Okay? Okay, I think a particularly simple example because I have three identical graphs. Okay, you could rework this thing if you had. Okay, so suppose we took an example where we have one graph like this, one graph like this, and then we looked at all the cases, this plus this, the whole thing. We looked at all of that. You can convince yourself, I'll leave this as an exercise for you. Like, you would just get this plus this, the whole thing, cube divided by. It's not a difficult. Yeah. And this generalizes it. Yeah. So it's a simple combinatorial problem. In the connected graphs, when exponentiated, produce with the right combinatorial factors, the sum of all graphs connected as well as disconnected. Okay? So this WJ, okay, this WJ is an object. This WJ is an object that can be computed by summing all connected graphs. By summing all connected graphs that contribute to this function. And contains all information of Z of J. For any purposes, it's a more useful object. You know, Z is, it's the logarithm of Z of J. As you remember, whenever we compute correlation functions, we differentiate the log of Z of J. So we differentiate W of J. Yeah, so W is more useful object than the Z of J.
So should it be ES to minus WJ because it makes more sense to have a partition function that is the nature of minus function?
Yeah, now this is a matter of course of convention. Certainly when we talk about the effective action, we'll call it minus gamma. I was trying to follow Weinberg. Unfortunately, Weinberg works in Minkowski space. So I'm not even sure I'm using the same as his conventions. I'm using some convention, okay? This is up to you. Okay. Maybe it should have been minus. Okay, excellent.
Sir, we get the similar graphs as a series. So, from there, how can we say that WJ is the sum of the connected graphs?
How can you say it? Okay, in this particular example, you saw that if you took all graphs which are distinct time to the power n copies of this, that will contribute simply what one of these graphs contributes to the power n divided by n factorial. But that's exactly what you would get by taking this particular connected graph and exponentiating it. So this particular example, you see how it works? So now you want to see how it generalizes? Well, I didn't answer the question.
As in, like, what I can understand is, you're taking these similar copies, so as a whole, this is a disconnected diagram.
Yes. So what I'm saying is that this WJ is computed by summing all disconnected graphs. Summing all connected graphs. So it's the sum of this, which is one connected graph, plus this, which is another connected graph. So you draw all connected graphs that you can.
Okay.
Fine. Yeah. Okay, excellent. So let's move on. Cross disconnect, no. Product of the two disconnected.
No, cross. So WG consists of all the connected graphs, you say?
Yes.
And when you drew this thing, when you had one connected graph plus another connected graph, you say that this will be just like the sum. So you will have cross graphs. And then,
you will have cross graphs. So suppose the answer for this graph was A. The answer for this graph was B. Okay? Now you definitely have graphs of the form square of two copies of this times one copy of this. This is there, it's not zero. You want to know what is the how does it contribute? It doesn't match. Because the full answer is A plus B. So the expansion of this gives you all the cross graphs. For instance, if you want the graph with two A's and one B, you expand this, so you will get A squared by 2. B.
So, but then this will be a disconnected graph.
Yes, yes. So that's the point of this whole thing. Summing all connected graphs You see, to compute a partition function, you need all graphs connected as well as this. But if you sum all connected graphs and exponentiate the answer, that generates all disconnected graphs.
Okay.
All graphs with connected, disconnected.
Okay.
Is this clear?
So WJ has all graphs.
WJ has all graphs. It's the sum of all connected
graphs.
Z of J has all graphs. Z of J is the exponential of WJ. Excellent. Now this WJ is an interesting object, but there is another object that is built out of WJ that is perhaps even equally interesting, maybe more interesting. Okay, also very interesting. Okay, and that other object goes as follows. That other object it goes by saying, let us consider WJ minus J times phi Cn. Now, we have to be a bit careful with notation. We had the integration variables phi in the original action. Those were some integration variables. We integrated them out and W is a function only of the sources J. This phi Cl, logically, has nothing to do with the integration variable. I'm using the same symbol, so I put that Cl. Okay? It's just some number, some function. Okay? This object here, as it stands, is a function of J and phi. It's a function of two things. Now, there is this interesting trick in mathematical physics that all of you know about. Anyone who studied thermodynamics knows about it. It's called the Legendre transform. Which is another way of saying, take this function and regard it as an action for the variable J. So extremize it with respect to J. So gamma of phi Cn is this quantity, W minus J phi Cl. Okay? W J minus J phi Cl. It's a function only of phi Cn, because you think of this as an action for the variable J. Extremize J and evaluate W on the solution to the equation of motion. Okay? Let me show you that this is what we normally, well, maybe these are not the words that are normally used to describe a Legendre transform. It's the most best way though. Okay? Let me show you how that works. So what do I mean in particular?
Why should we try to say J is being a free parameter, right? If we wanted to tune to 0 at the end.
We may or may not have wanted to tune to 0. Okay, for the purpose of computing correlation functions, it's true we wanted to put to 0 after differentiate.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, you know, W of J itself is an interesting function whose Taylor series, another way of saying this is that the Taylor series expansion coefficients of that are the correlators.
Right.
Okay, but I'm now treating W of J as an object in its own right. It's functional of J.
Yeah. Question is like, what's the use of doing this? Like just extremizing in respect to J puts a particular value for J, which is some phi Cl or something. But why?
You'll see. That's the point. Hang on 10-15 minutes. We'll try. Nobody stops you from doing what you want. The question is it useful?
Yeah.
Okay. So we'll see. Okay? So, what do I mean that I have to extremize by treating J as a variable? What I mean is I have to differentiate and set the derivative to 0. So, the equation I get from this is that del W by del J is equal to phi Cl. Okay? So this business about treating this object as an action for J and then evaluating on its minimum or on its solution the equations of motion is equivalent to saying that we want this object once we substitute for J by solving the equation. So, okay, which is the usual statement of Legendre? Okay, now the next question that I want to ask is, okay, this is nice. We've got a way of getting this phi CL from J by Legendre transform by doing this. I'm going to ask, is that an inverse of this relationship? Okay? So, is there a way of getting J, W of J, once I know phi C, once I know gamma of phi C? Okay? Well, clearly there is, because you see, suppose I take the object gamma of phi cl plus j tilde of phi cl. This once again is a function of j tilde and phi cl, functional of two. But I am going to define a new function as w tilde to be this object as a function of j tilde evaluated on the solution to the classical equations of motion of that object regarding phi cl as a value. Okay? That is this part. Now I'm going to show you that this process gives w tilde as equal to w. It's almost obvious. Why? Because what was the definition of this? It was this. So this is w of j minus j phi cl, so minus j tilde phi cl. Okay? Minus j tilde phi cl. Where, what are we supposed to do? Okay? Where we are supposed to take this object and vary it with respect to phi cl and with respect to j. Okay? But once I vary this object with respect to phi cl, it gives me the equation j is equal to j tilde. Once I've got j is equal to j tilde, that's the drops in. Moreover, since I've got j equals j tilde, I can just substitute this with respect as j tilde, then varying with respect to j does nothing. And I've got the answer. Okay? So what I'm saying is that it's obvious that this object here, as a function of j tilde, is the same thing as w as a function of j. Okay? So, Legendre transform should be thought of as following: objects, add a source, type something, and then make equation of motion with respect to that source. Okay, and when you think of it in this way, many of these, variational kind of properties become totally obvious. See, from variational principle. Okay, good. So this is our definition of phi, gamma of phi. See, any questions or comments?
Sir, you got a new definition of W0
this way. I get a new W, but the point is that it's the old. Now this is a function just of this j. Yeah, right. It's the new definition is that it's a Legendre transform of phi cl. Okay? Great. Great. So now let's move on. So this gamma of phi, whatever it is, just a Legendre transform of phi cl. But there is something very interesting about this this Legendre transform, and that goes as follows. You see, what was W of J? W of J was what you got. I mean, was the log of what you got when you did the full partition function here. Okay, Now I'm going to ask a seemingly strange question, but it may give you an interesting. And the seemingly strange question is, suppose I computed some Z double prime, some Z tilde of J. Okay. Suppose I computed this Z tilde of J. Okay. By, and I defined this object as exponential of minus gamma of phi plus j phi, the whole divided by some g. Okay? A partition function. Very strange thing, that is, I considered a path integral generated by the effective action gamma phi. I consider the path integral generated by this effective action gamma phi that replacing the action. Okay, and then I also put a 1 over g here, you know, like a, this is like h bar. Okay. What I want to know is, what, if any, is the connection? What, if any, is the connection between this partition function and the original partition function of the problem? That's the question that we're asking. Is the question clear? Okay? So, the original partition function, Z is equal to e to the power w j. Now, is there any limit in which we will get?
So when phi is phi
plus, right, but now I've got a path integral. That's a function of j and g. Is there anything we can do to j or g in order to get something like w?
So when g
goes to 0. You see, because when g goes to 0, saddle points work. Then you have to differentiate this thing with respect to phi. But that is the definition of w j.
Have I got my signs on it?
Yeah, there should not be minus.
That's very good.
I think I want, you know, I want gamma to be like an x. Okay, this is going to be my definition. Yeah, I want gamma to reduce to S in some of the right. Okay. Now you see, therefore, okay, that in the g goes to 0 limit, this thing would simply be Z tilde is simply exponential of W of j by g plus higher order than g. Okay? But what graphs contribute in the limit g goes to 0? See, suppose we're doing a path integral like this. We're computing the process. What graphs contribute in the limit g goes to 0? Only tree graphs. This you know, right? G is a loop problem. Okay? Therefore, if we sum all three graphs for this action and compute the generating function, we get the same answer. We get the exact answer. This 1 by g, of course, is a formal parameter. Right? It would appear in all the three graphs. We don't want it. Take resistor loop counting parameter in the end of Z1. All we're doing is, so we've reached the conclusion that gamma, that if you use gamma of phi in place of the action, But some only three graphs from gamma phi. Okay? Then you produce the exact generator of correlation functions. Okay? So, let's take this again. Gamma of phi is the action, the object with which, if you do classical physics, you get the exact quantum. Is this clear? Okay? So, gamma of phi is called the quantum effect of action. And we've already seen one use of it. Okay? It is the object such that if you do classical physics, that is, you sum all three graphs from it, okay? You will produce exact generator correlation. Now, let's imagine. Let's imagine we're computing some W of J in phi to the fourth area. Okay? So suppose we've got J.
Can be computed by summing all one particle irreducible graphs and whose
external legs are now interpreted as just phi fields. Okay? So we have come to a prescription for how to compute gamma of phi more effectively than actually computing the Legendre transform. We draw all Feynman graphs. Keep only those that are one particle irreducible. Allow external lines. But the external lines are to be are associated with the phi classical. Okay? And the sum of all such graphs with arbitrary numbers of insertions of phi classical. The phi classical is an arbitrary function. Okay? Gives you gamma of G. In Feynman diagrams, we often think of just this phi classical momentum space. But if you've got an arbitrary momentum, you've got an arbitrary function. Is this clear? In particular, in the process of computing phi of gamma, you do not insert propagators on external lines. You see, because the propagators have been taken into account. Is this clear? Is this clear?
But now these vertices are no more FIFO vertices. They are something else.
There is something totally different. They will be in general all orders, whatever. But it's the object, okay? The vertices of gamma of phi is that object that you get by looking at all one particle irreducible graphs, allowing external lines, and for those external lines, you do not put propagators. Those are just external lines.
You put the propagator at the level of gamma.
What?
You put the propagator at the level of gamma.
You connect this. You see, that's
the propagator from gamma.
From you, the vertex of gamma times the propagator times the vertex from. Right. Because the propagator, it would be overcome if you put a propagator in.
Yeah.
Okay. Also, when you compute W of J from gamma, you will have the J times phi. And that process will put a propagator here. Okay. So gamma itself does not have that propagator. Okay? So we got...
But those two vertices are not same.
What?
Maybe different.
Many different. All of these are distinct vertices. Okay? So what you have to do is to sum over all one particle irreducible graphs with external insertions of phi's. Okay? That gives you gamma of phi. Now, there is one even more elegant way of saying this. And that even more elegant way goes as follows. Suppose in your original action here, you put phi plus phi c, and you did the path integral. Okay, so suppose we do Z is equal to exponential d phi exponential minus phi plus phi c. Now, if we genuinely did such an answer, a path integral, how would the answer depend on phi c? At least if it had known phi be a variability. The answer would be this thing that I've written down here. The answer would be independent of phi cn. Because you already make the change of variables. Phi tilde is equal to phi plus phi cn. That absorbs that into the path integral. Yes. However, suppose we compute this thing subject to the restriction that we regard this as the exponential of only 1pi irreducible graphs. Connected 1pi irreducible. So we do this, we don't really do this part of the time. We do this at the graphical level by exponentiating all the connected 1pi irreducible. The 1pi irreducible is totally crucial statement. 1pi irreducible graphs, okay, with phi not regarded as external fields. those 1pi irreducible graphs are exactly what we said we should be computing. Because you remember what we said we should, is that we should compute all graphs with arbitrary numbers of external insertions. And those external insertions should be replaced by phi cn. Okay? But when you expand this, that's what you get. For instance, in phi 2 4 theory, like here, this vertex is a vertex where these two are phi's, but these two are phi cn's. So these were all phi's. These were phi's, but this was a phi cn. These were. These three were phi's, this was a phi cn. These two were phi's, this was a phi cn. These two were phi cn's. Okay? In any place that you. The substitution phi plus phi cn automatically puts all possible external insertions of phi cn. Exactly. And therefore, the conclusion is the following. Okay? Suppose you compute the path integral with phi replaced by phi plus phi c. You compute this path integral, you don't really compute a path integral, you do the strange thing of computing the exponential of connected one particle irreducible graphs. Because you're not really doing an integral, you can't shift away phi c n. Okay? And that process graphically, obviously, generates all the graphs that compute phi c, gamma phi c. And therefore, this object computes gamma of phi c. Okay? So gamma of phi c, the most convenient way to compute it through Feynman diagrams is to pretend we're just integrating phi out of this thing, but restrict attention only to one particle irreducible. Mathematically sharp. Meaning it's not you are asking, it doesn't go beyond perturbation theory.
Yeah, I guess.
Yes. So since I'm giving you this restriction to one particle irreducible graphs,
yeah.
So graphically. Otherwise
you'd have phi cn squared terms everywhere.
What?
Otherwise if you actually made the expansion you'd have phi cn squared terms, right?
We have phi cn squared. We have all powers of phi cn.
Yeah, gamma. Phi cn squared are the same vertex. You won't have 1pi, you won't have that.
No, you do. So this was 2 phi cn.
Yeah.
You just add the graphical level. Yeah. At any order of the loop expansion, this is totally precise.
Yeah.
Okay? If you want me to give you a definition that is non perturbative, that doesn't depend on graphical analysis, may be possible to do this way, but this basically is a graphical scale.
Yeah. How does it change the nature of the vertices? Like in this one, I always have a 5-4 thing, right? Like even if I shrink the loop level diagram to a tree level diagram.
No, but this.
We have an external line also in the lower graph, right? Because now we have that.
Okay, but this particular vertex was a 5-cube vertex.
This was a 5-4 vertex.
1, 2, 3, 5, 6. And this particular vertex was also a 5. Let me draw you a phi. Let me draw for you a phi to the 10 vertex. That's a phi to the 10 vertex. You see? Where these are phi's and these are phi cn's. This is an effective phi to the 10 vertex.
So if you could start from phi 4, let's say, and then whatever vertices were being generated in the RG, those vertices will also be generated. For example, phi 2 vertex won't be generated.
Have I done that? Okay, maybe. Yeah.
Yeah, that is actually phi 4, the external lens.
Oh yeah, you're right. I forgot about this. Yes, both of these are back. You're right. Actually, 5 goes to minus 5, so we'll forbid you from generating 5 cube.
Yeah.
Yeah, right. But you can generate phi to the 6, phi squared, phi to the 10.
Yeah.
Do you see this?
Yes.
Yeah, sorry, I said wrong. That was, yeah.
Another thing is, I don't understand. I understood that you could shrink that loop level to a tree level and that thing, but how making the action going, making phi to phi plus phi here, how this gives me the same thing?
Okay. So let's take an example. Okay, let's take the following effective phi to the 4 connection. In phi to the 4. Okay? What was our prescription? Our prescription was that we should compute this graph where these external lines were phi seals. Okay? But now suppose I had phi plus phi cl, the whole thing square. A vertex like this, and another phi plus phi cl, the whole thing square. There is a term in this which is phi square phi cl square. There's another term in this which is phi square phi cl square. I can contract these two phi's together. You see that generates exactly this graph. Are you understand?
Yes.
No, phi cl is regarded as a background field. Okay, the path integral is being done only over phi. So you take phi cl, set it to some functional value. Phi cl is some function. Substitute s is equal to phi plus phi cl. And in the graphs, you do the integration only over phi's. The answer is a functional of phi cl. Okay? Provided you sum only over one particle irreducible connected graphs, the answer to that problem is gamma of phi. Is this clear? Okay? This, by the way, since Mangesh brought it up, is very similar to Wilsonian renormalization. Zeshan group, how is it similar? Remember, in the renormalization group, when they're bringing the integral over a shell, we broke up phi's into phi's that had momentum inside the shell and phi's that had momentum below. So, the phi's that had momentum inside the shell are like these phi's. And the phi's that had momentum below are like phi cl's. By integrating on the momentum inside the shell, we got a functional only of low momentum phi's. Like that, we're getting a functional only of low momentum phi cl's. That was a precise relationship. Provided you have a theory with no infrared divergences. Okay, infrared divergences can spoil the statement I'm making. But if you're in a theory with no infrared divergences, then gamma of phi cl, okay, is the same as the Wilsonian effective action run down to arbitrary low energies. Okay? And why do you know that's true? You see, a Wilsonian effective action run down to very low energies. Once you've got a Wilsonian effective action at some scale, in order to compute correlation functions, you need to do the integral over all momenta up to that scale. If you run down very low energies, you have to do basically no momentum integrals at all. And therefore you get it more or less by classical answer. But we've seen that gamma phi cl is the object whose classical physics generates the exact correlations. Okay? So there is a tight relationship between it's imprecise in a couple of directions, as I said. Okay? But conceptually, there is a tight relationship between the between gamma of phi, which is called the quantum effective action, and what is sometimes called the Wilsonian effective action, integrating it out, everything out quite a bit. Okay? There are a couple of inaccuracies, as I said.
Yes, ma'am.
In fact, there's a famous study of the relationship between these two objects. Yeah, we will not get it. Okay, great. Any other questions or comments about this?
So when you compact these phi's,
yes,
you will calculate some integration.
Yes.
Integration. What
will
be your limits?
Minus infinity to infinity. You see, here we're not doing anything. Okay? If you've got a cutoff in your theory, some large UV cutoff, you do it with that cutoff. We're just doing the path integral. You first will define your path integral, like we do for quantum field theory. Okay? And then you do it. I mean, we're not touching on that. So this is a much less subtle discussion than that of renormalization. It's trivial manipulations for combinatorial manipulations. Okay? So let me summarize what we've learned.
In the second year of looking at it, how do you generate phi-CL propagators?
How do you generate phi-CL propagators? Well, for instance, this term would contribute to...
No, that's fine. Like, diagrams where you have phi-CL in the internal line. A two vertex diagram would have phi-CL internal line.
No, we don't. There's no such thing as a phi-CL.
Well, it's fine, though.
It's a... you see... What? Yeah. All we're trying to do is generate these effective vertices. And then we will later, in order to generate, let's say, some correlation function, we will later get all three graphs using these vertices. So this propagator here will come in that process.
Isn't getting three graph same as contracting 1515?
If we had such a vertex, we would have some effective renormalized. Then we would put the propagator.
Okay. Oh, so you're putting it as a separate step.
Exactly.
Okay.
We're caught shipping all of these.
Okay.
Sir, for example, in this diagram, when we shrink the loop, the number of vertices is reducing by one, right? I mean, like, for example, that entire loop thing won't contribute anymore. The all four, five.
Yeah, this whole thing shrinks to one, five,
yeah,
four.
But each vertex is associated with some lambda, right? So shouldn't the two diagrams have same powers of lambda, but from here they are not.
No, so in gamma, we will generate vertices at all orders and complements.
So that will compensate.
Yeah, so this object, for instance, is a phi to the 4 vertex in gamma that is order lambda squared. This object was also phi to the 4 vertex in gamma, but at order lambda. This object is the same thing at order lambda to the 4. So we will generate the quantum effective action. We will generate vertices of phi to the 4, phi to the 6, and all orders in it.
Shouldn't they be same? Like,
what should what?
The powers of lambda.
No. Why? Why should?
Because it's essentially the same diagram, right? Like,
let's look at this. This is a function for process. This contributes to four. Two boson scattering. So this occurs at lambda to the 4. So gamma, for instance, can be used to compute scattering processes by using. Task. Okay, all of this is something else. Because in the end, you end up teaching much less than you mean to. But if we really have this extension in the next semester, we go through all. Like the LSZ procedure, you understand. Okay, we'll discuss those. This is all classic physics. Okay, if you know correlators, you can get S matrices. Since you can compute all correlators from gamma, you can compute all S matrices. Okay, so gamma is another way of saying it, is it generates all S matrices. Just by the classical physics. Does anyone know how to get S matrices from classical physics? What is a classical? It's a classical analog of an S matrix. Suppose I wanted, let me sharpen my question. Suppose I have phi to the 4 theorem. And I want, if you do compute S matrices at tree level, you're never doing more than classical physics. So the tree level phi to the 4 S matrix, or the tree level phi to the 10 S matrix, is the answer to some classical question in classical physics. Can somebody tell me what that classical question that you have to answer to compute?
Sir, when we compute S matrices, like at the tree level, we essentially contract the phi's with the momenta, right? So if you think of it classically, it will like
putting some initial conditions and some final conditions and like something like Laplace equation.
Yes, very good. Very good. But it says more or less right. But what do you compute? What the S matrix is a complex number. What do you have to compute? Well, when you compute a transition amplitude, quantum transition amplitude going from here to here in quantum mechanics, what do you have to, what is the classical if the h power goes to limit it reduces to a classical problem? What is the classical quantity you have to compute? Action. Action is a function of boundary values. Okay? So, as you said, this the classical computation that gives you the S matrix is the action, field theory action is a function of boundary values, where you have to put some boundary conditions. Okay? And the boundary conditions you put are final boundary conditions. A lot of you have read about a quantum field theory and have never understood these negative energies here or positive energies there. You know what I'm talking about? No. Okay, you're a different generation. When we first studied quantum field theory, we heard about this. It was some crazy intuitive stuff. What? Where did it come from? In the modern field theory, we don't talk about it. But with some appropriate boundary conditions that I won't get into. It's computing an action as a function of stuff here and stuff there with some appropriate boundary conditions. So if you did that action calculation, but with gamma, that will give you the exact S matrix. Okay, we'll discuss some of this stuff. We'll have a proper discussion of scattering if we really continue next semester. Okay, we'll have a proper discussion of scattering, unitarity and scattering, things like that. Interesting things. Okay. But let's move on. Okay. So, there is one more formal property of the quantum effective action that I want to tell you about, which in some ways is one of its most important properties. And that is that there is an energy interpretation of the quantum effective action. You know, okay, so let me first tell you the statement, and then we will write it. The statement is as follows. So, suppose I have gamma of phi. Phi is some classical function. And I evaluate gamma of phi. Okay? Let me restrict my attention to time-independent phi's. So, I've got some spatially varying field. Right? And I evaluate gamma of phi. That is a function, so you get a number. Okay? We've talked about how gamma as a function of phi, it's Legendre transform, blah blah blah. Out vertices are important in computing various processes. But the question that you might ask is one that Ronak alluded to at some point. You know what is the meaning of gamma of phi itself? And this is a very interesting interpretation. Okay. Gamma of phi, you see, suppose we ask the question. For a time-independent field configuration in classical physics, what is S of phi? The answer to that question is minus the potential energy times time. Okay? So if you divide by the volume of space-time, assuming translation is there, you know. If you divide by time, you get the energy of the configuration that has that value of gamma, that get that value of phi. Saying it badly, you know what I mean, right? That's why I tried to restrict myself to time independent things, so it wouldn't make a difference. Okay, let me remind you of quantum mechanics. Suppose I have action, say that either Euclidean, as in it does to you. Yeah, x star squared by 2 minus v of x. Okay, I compute what is the interpretation of this action as a function of x if x is time independent. It's v of x up to some sign, it's just the energy of the configuration. Okay? That's what that's the thing that I'm trying to say. Okay. So now you might wonder whether gamma of phi c, at least for time and configurations, also has some interpretation in terms of an energy. But of course, now we're going to do quantum physics, we're doing classical physics. So energy of what? Energy of which state? States are not labeled by phi cn, by some function. That's a basic difference between classical and quantum physics. So it sounds at first like it cannot have an energy interpretation of a particular state. But the answer is that it does. And the answer is that this is the interpretation. Let me tell you the answer, and then we try to prove it. The answer is that suppose you take all states psi in the Hilbert space of the quantum field. We restrict our attention to normalized states. Okay? And we look at those states such that the expectation value of phi in the state is phi c. Okay? Now, vary over all such states and find the minimum energy. The minimum energy in the infinite number of states that whose expectation value at phi of x, of the operator phi of x, is phi c. The answer, the minimum of that energy is gamma of phi c.
Sir, so the fact that we wrote the gamma phi cell as a no longer transform, it's essentially like Ehrenfest's theorem, right? Thinking about in terms of expectation, since we can write the Hamiltonian as a Lagrange transform as well. So, in some sense, is it?
Okay. Yeah. You see, we Lagrange transform gamma from W. Because the Legendre transform is a classical analog of the converse of what we did to get W from S. We did the Legendre transform because Legendre transform is just in classical physics. Path integral is doing quantum physics. Okay. So the point is that gamma is like the object whose classical physics gives you the quantum answer very well. Now if that is the same as what you're saying about Ehrenfest's theorem, then it's right. Okay. Do you understand my claim before we go on to try to demonstrate? Is the claim clear to everyone? It's a very powerful claim. The claim is that take all states in the quantum field theory whose such that the expectation value of the operator phi in that state is phi c. There are an infinite number of states. For instance, in quantum mechanics, this would be this. Just take all states such that the expectation value of x is a particular number. There are an infinite number of such states, of course. All wave functions, such that the average value of x in that wave function is x0 contributes clearly an infinite number. It's much greater infinity here because much bigger in the space. Now, so different states in this class have different energies. Now we minimize the energy among all such states. Look at the lowest energy state among this class of states. And we ask, what is its energy? And the answer is gamma of phi c by time. Is this clear?
Maybe you have to sum all the expectation values.
What?
Maybe you have to sum all expectation values.
No, no. This is a constraint. We're looking at both sides. Now obey this constraint. Okay? So we're doing a constrained maximization. Okay? Is the claim clear? Now the proof is an almost trivial one. It's kind of proof where you wonder whether you're cheating yourself. Okay. that is very beautiful. See, suppose we wanted to solve this maximization problem. So what do we want to do? We want to extremize subject to the constraint that this is true and that psi is normalized. Now, all of you know of a way of doing constrained extremization. That's the method of Lagrange multipliers. This is another way of saying you impose the constraint as a delta function, right? Okay, that's another way of saying it. Let's say it. Okay. So, what is the method of Lagrange multipliers? Method of Lagrange multipliers says that you add a Lagrange multiplier times the constraint. So suppose we add a Lagrange multiplier alpha times the constraint psi bar psi, because I'm putting the condition psi bar psi is equal to 1. And another Lagrange multiplier, let's say beta x, times the constraint psi psi phi of x psi. Okay?
Minus
phi z. No, the method of Lagrange multipliers. Okay, we can do it either way. You can use the method of Lagrange multipliers or put the delta function. I could have done this as minus 1 and this minus phi cl. But the way Lagrange set the method of Lagrange multipliers, just take this object, differentiate it with respect only to psi, and adjust alpha and beta so that the constraints are met. It's the same thing. Okay? So you take this object, differentiate it with respect to psi, that gives you an equation, and then you have to solve that equation for those values of alpha and beta so that the constraints that you're interested in are met. It's clearly the same thing, right? Because you see, if we put this minus 1 here, or the minus phi c here, the derivative of this action with respect to phi doesn't change. Okay? And then the remaining equations that you get when differentiating with respect to alpha and respect to beta are just simply the condition that the constraints are met. So you just have to adjust alpha and beta so that the constraints are met. Okay. So, what is the equation we get? We get h psi plus alpha psi plus beta of x phi of x times psi. Okay, is equal to 0, where alpha and beta have to be chosen so that these two constraints are met. Okay, so we have to solve this equation plus the equation plus an equation plus we have to solve this equation for those alpha and beta that ensure that this and this are. Okay. Now the observation is that we already know of a solution about to this problem. Let us try to understand how. Okay. Suppose we consider this exponential z of t equal to exponential of minus s of pi plus j pi. If our j is taken to be time independent, okay, if our j is taken to be time independent, then we can think of this whole thing here as some, the whole thing as quantum mechanics of some time independent Hamiltonian. where J is some of is a new coupling inside that I'm doing. Okay? And this Hamiltonian domain, whatever it is, has a ground state. Okay? And clearly, W of J is equal to 1 over time, or is equal to time, minus time times E of J, where E of J is the ground state energy of that ground state. Because the Z of J is, you know, just it's e to the power minus beta h over an infinitely long time. So only the ground state energy contributes. Right? Think of this, for instance, as the limit of time being on a circle and the size of that circle going to infinity. So time being on a circle, as we have explained in class, is trace of e to the power minus beta h. Beta is the size of the circle. When beta goes to infinity, only the lowest energy state contributes. Okay? So you get just the energy of that thing takes time.
So if it's e to the power minus beta, it should be 1 over t, because beta is...
Now, t was like time,
not temperature.
T is the size of the time circle. Let's call that beta. Okay, the size. Yeah, okay, imagine we're doing this on a very large circle whose circumference is beta. Okay, so what do we know? We know that the Hamiltonian of this problem, okay, so that there is some state which is the ground state of this quantum phase theory with this J. Okay, let's call that state psi J, okay? Psi 0 J. Such that the Hamiltonian of that problem on psi 0 k is W of J. Okay? So the Hamiltonian of that problem is the Hamiltonian of this problem plus minus, what is this? Plus, minus the wave, right? Minus J times Y. It's just an additional term for the potential. So I'm saying that the Hamiltonian that we're really interested in, that was really the thing, minus J times Y, on there exists some psi 0 J such that this object is equal to W of J psi 0. What else do we know? Of course, we can choose the psi 0 j to be normalized. So let's do that. And what else do we know about psi 0 j? What else do we know about psi 0 j? Another thing that we know about psi 0 j is that that the expectation value of phi of x in psi 0 j, which is the same thing as d phi exponential of divided by d phi exponential of okay. Is simply del W of J by del J. But del W of J by del J was 5 years. And therefore, we also know that phi 0 J, phi of X, phi 0 k is equal to phi 0. Now, let us compare these three equations. So we have equation 1, we have equation 2, and we have chosen phi c. This was the trivial. Phi cl, phi cl. Phi cl to be equal to 1. Okay, so this is equation 2 and this is equation 3. Therefore, this phi 0 j is an object that satisfies our two constraints. This constraint as well as this constraint. And moreover, quite incredibly, satisfies this equation. Provided we identify, you know, it has to satisfy this equation for both alpha and beta. Would satisfy that, right? So we found a solution provided we identify alpha with w of my alpha equal to minus w of j and beta is equal to minus j.
Integral g phi?
Where?
In the h minus j phi equation.
Uh-huh.
It will be integral j phi.
Yeah, right. This is integral j. No, well, let's see. Wait. Let me think about that. Plus Now beta of phi was what? Minus j. Minus j of x. And this was phi cl of x. Because the expectation value of phi when phi j 0 was phi cl. It equal to 0. And therefore, this expectation value, phi 0 of j, h phi j 0, is equal to w of j plus integral j of x phi x dl of x. So that is the same thing as gamma phi up. You get my minus. Extremize overall states. So, I mean, we almost never think like that for quantum field theory. Right? This little formal manipulation allows you to see that gamma measures the lowest energies, the lowest energy of all states, such that expectation of value of phi in that state is phi zero. Right? So you see, there is value to computing not just gamma as a power series expansion of phi. Something that helps you to generate final data. There's value to actually knowing the number. Okay. One thing this is useful for is to understand when symmetry value happens. Okay? Because if you find, suppose you find gamma as a function of constant values of phi, what that is giving you is the potential of your problem. And if that potential has a dip somewhere away from phi equal to 0, you know the field theory will have a concept there, because that means that there is a state which is lower energy when the expectation value of phi is a value than when the expectation value of phi is 0. So the question about whether you're working around the right vacuum of your theory is effectively addressed by computing the shape of gamma of phi, even for constant values of by assuming that your vacuum is translational. In many quantum field theories, it's true that vacuum is translational invariant. So you characterize whether symmetry breaking is happening or not, whether, you know, where the true vacuum of the theory is, by computing gamma of phi for constant phi. It's actually a very useful thing, because while gamma is a formal object, it's a complicated object. It's as an object as a function of constant phi, it's often not very complicated. It's just a number, it's a function. Not a functional. Okay, now at this point, what I wanted to do was to. How hungry are you people? let me take 15 minutes. Okay, so what I wanted to do is to give you an example of a computation of gamma of phi and phi to the fourth theory at one loop to obtain what is called the Kolmogorov-Weinberg image.
I think
the
tapestry.
The tapestry. If you don't mind, if he's not there, maybe we can push him.
So when we actually compute the gamma for the one, we are putting in the dimensions.
Yes, you
have to do
it. You'll see this. Maybe we should do the next time. Maybe we should start at least doing that dimension. Let's postpone this. Okay, so this is unrelated to our discussion of gauge theories, but is of interest in its own right, and illustrates the use of the quantum mechanics. In a simple way. He's coming. I was just thinking maybe we should postpone actually. What do you people feel? Do you have the energy to start a new calculation? I'm scared that in 15 minutes we want to finish, and then we have a week's break and you won't remember. Let's postpone that to next time. Okay, next week there's no class. Next week I'm out of town. We're going to resume week after next. Okay. the Monday week after next. That's actually a couple of weeks decided to stop.
So we can actually there is time.
There's time still remaining on the day?
Two minutes.
2 minutes, okay, that's more than enough. Okay, yeah, thanks. So the reason we're going to compute this golden mind potential is it gives you an illustration of how to compute, and gives you an illustration of the kind of questions you're asking. That's really organizational. So on. Gives you an illustration of how to compute this one loop effective action. One loop in a very nice physical context. Actually, it's also very important. It's the kind of calculation that is used to, as all of you know, the Higgs field has this double well potential. Higgs condenses that leads to spontaneous symmetry vector. But I'm not sure if you know this, but if you take the standard model and heat it up, the actual effective action for this Higgs field gets modified as a function of temperature. And there is a temperature that is large enough so that the Higgs stabilizes around its around phi equals zero. Spontaneous symmetry breaking does not happen. Okay? And the kind of calculation that shows you this is just a finite temperature version of the calculation between the gaps. So it's a very simple kind of thing. Yet has a lot of real physics. Okay, so we'll discuss this, and then in the next class, we'll discuss this, and I either in the subsequent class or the one after that, we will then do the same computation of the one-loop quantum effective action for a non-abelian gauge theory. And that will help us understand the beta function precisely because you're here. Okay.